Hello, I'm Roger McLaughlin, Chief Executive of the Westerly Group. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to our Christmas Remembrance Service. Now, of course, with COVID, things are much harder to organise this year than in the past. And there was a danger we couldn't have this service at all. But our colleagues, together with our audiovisual partners, Obitus, have come to the rescue. And hence, we're doing this webcast live to you this evening. And also recorded for those of you who can't attend at this time. Of course, I mentioned there COVID, and it's affected all of us. And much has been written and said about how devastating it's been. And sadly, we have lost many lives. But you know, there has been an awful lot of good come out of this pandemic too. There are heroes in every community, in every walk of life. People who've really gone the extra mile. And of course, yes, there's all the key workers. NHS have been magnificent, as have been lorry drivers getting food to the supermarkets, teachers who carried on teaching and looking after the young people. And in every community, there's someone who has gone the extra mile, a real hero. Whether they've just brought about a smile, whether they've checked on their neighbours, whether they've got shopping for them. Or perhaps it's been you, making a call to someone who you haven't spoken to for a while. Make more of those calls, especially at Christmas. There's never been a better time to do it. So phone a friend. And of course, if I may, I'd like to thank all our Westerly colleagues who have been magnificent during this pandemic. They have worked tirelessly, all hours, with great dedication. To provide the love, the exceptional care for absolutely everyone who's suffered a bereavement. So tonight, please do enjoy this service. Enjoy the singing, enjoy taking part as much as you can, and have a very Merry Christmas. Thank you.
Good evening. A warm welcome to the Vale's first memorial service. Not how we imagined we would be welcoming you at what has been a challenging year for all, not least for those who have suffered a bereavement. Over the next 40 minutes or so, we hope you will find time for reflection and comfort of happy times gone by as we enter into the Christmas season and the year draws to a close. I will now pass you on to my colleague and civil servant, Mandy Wood.
Thank you, Catherine, and a very warm welcome to you all. I have worked in bereavement for a few years now and have met many families along the way that have had to come to terms with the loss of a loved one. There is absolutely nothing in this world that can ever prepare us for such loss. This year especially has been extremely hard for families that have suffered tragic loss, loss due to illness, and loss due to life that has barely started. Maybe you would join me in a few thoughts about life and death. The difference and uniqueness of each human life is the basis of our grief and bereavement. Look through the whole wide world and there is no one else like your loved one. They still live on in your memories, though no longer a visible part of our lives. They will remain a member of your family or circles throughout the influence that they've had on you and the special part they have played in your lives. We know that the value and meaning of our life consists in living it and living it well. With Christmas looming, we know that facing this period alone or whilst grieving can be a very daunting prospect, but you consider different ways of celebrating, and these can be things that you either do alone or with friends and family close to your heart. So, although it's sad to reminisce on Christmases we once knew, this year I shall celebrate in memory of you. I'll put aside my sorrow with every unshed tear and concentrate on all the joy we shared when you were here. Our time together taught me what Christmas time is for, and that's what I'll remember until we meet once more. And finally, those we love will never be more than a thought away. As long as there's a memory, they will live on in our hearts to stay. And we are now going to listen to a piece of music, Christmas Lullaby, composed by John Rutter and sung by the Cambridge Singers.
Thank you. Good evening to you all here who are with me today and all those joining us via the webcast. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Kevin Bowen and I'm a funeral director at Merstow Green Funeral Home in Evesham. Firstly, I'd like to say a big thank you to Westerly for arranging this Christmas remembrance service today and for all of my colleagues and associates here taking part. It is a shame in the current climate that we're living in that we're not able to have more people here attending, but I'm positive that next year things will become better and hopefully this will be an annual event for everyone to attend. Christmas can be an immensely painful time for those who have lost loved ones. And while grief never fully goes away, there will be times when emotions are much more heightened than others and when the sense of loss can feel greater. Christmas, the season which celebrates love and family time, is certainly one of those occasions. The poem I'm going to read today is for those who've experienced the loss of a baby or a child. The death of a child, no matter how old they are, is one of the most hardest things to come to terms with. Only 5 years ago, myself and my wife, Cheryl, lost a baby during pregnancy, and it's impossible to convey the depth of shock and grief we both felt. So whether this is your first awful Christmas after a loss, or whether you're a few years further down the line, this poem is for you, and it's titled, Does Heaven Have a Christmas Tree? Does heaven have a Christmas tree for the little girls and boys, too far away for Santa's sleigh to reach with treats and toys? A tree that's hung with moonbeams, stars, and real shining angel hair for the precious little children who all live in heaven's care. And are you filled with wonder at its branches all aglow with the tears of those who miss you on this earth far down below? For we hope and pray you're playing with the angels, having fun. But please don't forget we love you. Happy Christmas, little one. Thank you. We are now going to listen to a beautiful carol titled, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Thank you. My name is Fiona Rhodes, and I'm a family celebrant now who's been working in Worcestershire for several years, and as a registrar of births, deaths, and marriages before that. I've had the privilege of looking after and helping so many families through one of the most difficult emotions of their lives, bereavement. I'm constantly heartened and pleasantly surprised at the love and pride within families, the strength and resilience they manage whilst coping with their losses. I'm a firm believer that our loved ones remain with us and in us forever. Our love for them does not die with them, but lives on. At every service, I'll close with this famous poem. Those we love don't go away. They walk beside us every day, unseen, unheard, but always near, still loved, still missed, and very dear. Those we love remain with us, for love itself lives on, and cherished memories never fade because a loved one's gone. Those we love can never be more than a thought apart, for as long as there is memory, they'll live on in the heart. Christmas is a special time of year when we naturally remember those loved ones who are gone, yet still feel part of the family. We have to continue to sing the song of life, carrying on living on their behalf, see things through their eyes, remember how they used to say things and use those words ourselves. We have to be thankful that we can do things that they cannot, and also feel the sadness of it. Laugh, smile, play. It would be impossible to forget someone who's given you so much to remember. And we must remember the good and happy times. Christmas can be a sad time too, and for some people it's difficult and challenging. Even as a little girl, I can remember feeling sad for other children who were in hospital and I was watching them on television. I had no personal reasons for feeling sad, but I felt empathy for those less fortunate, those who were lonely and isolated. And all these emotions are valid. In preparing for this today, I asked a lovely young mum who I worked with 3 years ago what I should say. We had to say fond farewell to her newly born son, and she acknowledged how difficult Christmases can be. Christmas is a time for children especially. According to her, we really should not feel pressure to be happy and smiley just because it's the season to be jolly. It's okay to be sad and it's okay to be happy. It's powerful to express and embrace a rainbow of emotions and for us to be able to freely talk about those family members who are gone. So if you know someone who has lost a very important person in their life and you're afraid to mention their name for fear of upsetting them and making them sad or reminding them that they died, fear not. By mentioning them and talking about them, you're reminding them that you remembered that they lived, and that's the greatest gift for Christmas. Families do find wonderful ways to keep their memories alive. And my young mum started a new handmade clothing line named after her son. So his spirit is to be found in all the children wearing the clothing she's made, which bear his name. A young widow made cushion covers from her husband's favourite shirts, and these are a great comfort to all the family who have them in their lounges. And only this year, during the first lockdown in the summer, I made bunting for the garden out of my dad's old shirts. Whatever helps to get by is fine. There are no rules, no dot to dot of the right path. Just do the best you can while being very kind to yourselves at the same time. This year, more than any other, we can be kind to ourselves as well as others. Let's all go very gently. And we'll now listen to a gentle piece of music by Faith Hill, Where Are You, Christmas? If we fill our hearts and minds with love, it will inevitably help us to find the true spirit of Christmas time.
Good evening. My name is Richard Hill, and I'm from E. Hill & Son Funeral Directors in Pershore, and I've been a funeral director for over 34 years. I'd like to thank the Vale Crematorium for inviting me to share a reading with you today, My reading is based on Ecclesiastes 3, which is a reading that often gets read at services here at the crematorium. But this is my interpretation of it, based on our current climate. The Bible tells us there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. Sadly, we know there is a time for dying, inevitably followed by a time of crying, a time of sadness and of grief, a time when we look in despair for relief. Unfortunately, most of the time this year has been filled with a nasty virus and fear. The government stated a time of separations from loved ones, friends, and relations. A time to refrain from hugging and kissing when old friends you meet and are obviously missing. A time of patience is what must follow. A time to protect all our tomorrows. A time of hope that the worst is now behind us. And by working together, a time to get rid of this awful virus. A time of optimism. A vaccine, we're told, is not far away. But until that time happens, at a distance, we must stay. But this virus must not spoil our Christmas time. Traditionally, a time of love, laughter, and wine. A time for Christmas trees, lights, and decoration. A time for Christmas greetings across our nation. A time to remember, whilst here on earth, that Christmas came because of Jesus' birth. A time for giving and receiving with meaning. A time for Christians, a time for kneeling and believing. A time for reflection on a year full of woe. A time for cleansing and to let those things go. A time for a new start, a new year is pending. The economy could do with our buying and spending. As we move forward to the new year and time, let's banish the fears of the one left behind. I hope you all manage to have a good Christmas, no matter what shape or form it comes. And remember, there is always someone worse off than yourself. So let's be thankful for small mercies. And now we're going to listen to Nat King Cole sing the famous carol, Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing.
Joy to the world.
Sounding joy, make the sounding joy.
He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness,
wonders of his love, and wonders of his love,
and wonders.
Hello, my name's Craig Bishop, and I'm a vicar in the Church of England. And I want to begin by reading you part of the Christmas story from the Gospel of St. Luke. In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, The time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of swaddling cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. That story from the Gospel of St. Luke is about something that happened a long time ago. And in some strange way, that's what's happening to us. The time that we're living through is going to be recorded in the history books. The coronavirus, its impact on the economy, upon us, upon our families and our loved ones, will be studied in the future by generations as yet unborn. The coronavirus has made the things that we once took for granted seem strange. A handshake with an acquaintance, a hug with a friend, an embrace with a family member, a kiss with somebody under the mistletoe. We're living in strange times, and this Christmas will be no different. This will be a strange Christmas. We don't yet know what will be permitted, but one thing which is for sure is it's unlikely to be like any Christmas we've ever had before. And for many of us, the strangeness of the coronavirus, the strangeness of this time, is amplified by the death of somebody we have loved. Death makes everything strange. Christmas without exchanging gifts with the person who has died will be strange. Sitting down to a Christmas meal without them will be difficult. As my colleagues have said, any occasion, any anniversary or important date is hard because of the loss you have suffered, and Christmas, this Christmas, will be no different. It's normal for us to want things to return to normal. But as it is with the virus, so it is with grief. We are living in a new place now, and it's not possible to return to the past. We may never get over our loss and our grief, but slowly we will learn to live with them. Slowly we will be less surprised when the pain of loss grabs us unawares, but times like Christmas will always be hard. The pain of grief is a reminder of the depth of love that we shared. The more we loved, the greater the pain. Over the last few weeks, I've read some headlines about people wanting to save Christmas. But that, of course, is the wrong way round. Christmas is here to save us. This is the faith of the church. A long time ago, in a distant country, heaven touched earth. And in that moment, everything was changed. A long time ago, in a distant country, God entered into our beautiful and broken world as a child born to a young mother, as Jesus, son of Mary. The beginning of John's Gospel, we are promised the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. That God became flesh and lived among us. When heaven and earth touched, God became flesh, a child born to a young mother in a normal family, in a normal town. Heaven and earth touched, and everything was changed. It was part of God's plan for saving us from the brokenness, from the pain, and the disappointment of this world. Heaven touched earth in Bethlehem at the birth of Jesus. But in some remarkable way, heaven and earth touch whenever love is shared. In the love that you share, heaven touches earth. Wherever love lives, God lives. Wherever love is found, God is found. Wherever love is cherished, heaven and earth touch. At this time, in this Christmas season, we need to live the life we have been given, discovering joy in small things, discovering that God is always with us in the good and in the bad, in the pain and in the joy, in the beautiful and in the broken. God's mercies never come to an end, they are new every morning. Jesus was born in Bethlehem so that we might know there is no limit to God's love. He is with us even when we feel alone. He loves us even when we can't feel it. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. We're going to listen to another carol now, and I don't think any Christmas service would be complete without listening to Hark the Herald Angels Sing. I'm going to lead some prayers using the Christmas story as our basis. If prayer is not something you're familiar with or comfortable with, then I invite you to think about those members of your family, that you love, whether they be close to you or far away, whether they be alive or dead. Father, your Son, our Saviour, was born in human flesh. We give thanks for the season of Christmas. We remember that there was no room for your Son in the inn. Protect with your love those who have no home and all those who live in poverty. In the pain of labour, Mary brought your Son to birth. Hold in your hand all who are in pain or distress. Christ came as a light shining in the darkness. Bring comfort to all who suffer in sadness. The angel sang, "Peace to God's people on earth." The shepherds in the field heard good tidings of joy. They rushed to the Holy Family and saw the babe lying in a manger. Bless our homes and all whom we love. At Christmas, heaven is come down to earth, and earth is raised to heaven. Hold in your hand all those who have passed through death into the hope of your coming kingdom. At Christmas, we celebrate Christ's birth. Open our hearts that he may live in us. A prayer for us. Your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy upon all who mourn. Give them patient faith in times of darkness. Strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. A closing prayer. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. May that light shine upon you. May darkness be scattered from before your path, this day, this Christmas, and always. Amen. Our service ends with driving home for Christmas.